Omar, it's a pleasure to have you on our program. I wanted to speak to you about the whole idea of asylum and apostasy, especially after Rahaf's case, and you yourself applied for asylum here in Sweden.
Yes.
As an atheist who had fled Egypt.
Mm.
You came across a lot of problems, though, and that's something I think others do too.
Yes.
What was the main problem with you not being accepted initially?
Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you for having me on your show. And yes, you are. It is a big problem here with ex-Muslims seeking asylum in Sweden because of the, let's say, the burden of proof. I think it's the migration agency exaggerates in placing demands on, let's say, proving that a person has left Islam. I think, yeah, unreasonable demands. So, for example, in my case, when I came here and applied for asylum, and I thought that I will just like tell them everything about my story and what I'm facing and so on, and they will just provide me with asylum. But my experience with the migration agency is that they were not really trying to evaluate the evidence that I gave them to ascertain whether I have a valid grounds for asylum, but they were more trying to find excuses to reject my asylum. So, for example, I remember when I showed them like stuff from social media and stuff, they said, oh, but maybe that's photoshopped. And I was like, but you can check that online. So some ridiculous stuff like that. And in the end, they did acknowledge that, for example, people in Egypt who leave Islam or are critical of Islam are being persecuted, but they refused to acknowledge that I was one, like I had left Islam. And they had said that had I been able to prove that, I would have been entitled to asylum. And another thing is that they said that I did not provide them with evidence that the Egyptian authorities are aware of my views on Islam, which is something that I cannot really do. I cannot ask the Egyptian embassy for a document saying that, oh yeah, we know that this guy is an atheist, and he's a pain in the ass.
Yeah. And of course, this is something we see quite regularly, don't we?
Yes.
People being refused.
Yes.
Based on the fact that they're not believed, and also asking for evidence that's just really impossible to get. I mean, unless you can bring your dead corpse and say, well, does this proof, is this proof enough that I'm going to be persecuted after the fact, you know?
Yeah, it's like Catch-22 thing. Yeah. So it's like, maybe you need to be in prison for you to get asylum, but if you're in prison, you cannot get asylum. But, well, of course, it's reasonable to some extent for people to prove that they have like to let their beliefs are genuine and they have like they have a genuine case at, and to talk about how they came to leave Islam and what they think about it and so on, but within reason, and this is something I would say that the migration board does not do for the most part, although it's also like sometimes also it can be a bit like a lottery, because there have been cases of ex-Muslims who have been granted asylum rather without too much of a fuss, so and it's something also the migration agency has been criticized for, that it there's like some kind of sort of like non-conformity. Exactly.
So what about, there's a case you're working on of an Iraqi atheist.
Yes.
He's also facing deportation, isn't he?
Yes, exactly. So Ahmed Al-Qamar is his name, and he's from Iraq, as you said, an ex-Muslim atheist. And he has been here in Sweden struggling for his asylum for 3 years now. And he's actually facing threats even from his father and his uncle. And he even provided the migration agency with a copy of, like, not even the copy, the original of an arrest warrant that is against him in Iraq, with like a sentence from the court related to his atheism, him being vocal about his atheism. but still he was rejected by the migration agency time and again, because of the same thing. They are saying that he has not proved to them that he has left Islam.
So even an arrest warrant isn't enough for them?
No, but that's the thing. Like, in my experience and in other cases I've seen, in some of the other cases I've seen at least, it seems to me, like from my point of view, it's like this. You provide the migration board with a case. What they do is they look into it and try to find, okay, here, how will we reject this? What can we say about this and that so that we reject it? This is, it seems to me, their approach. This is their angle, in a way. And I think it's supposed to be the other way around.
Yeah, definitely. Mm. And it's interesting because now you finally have asylum after a big fight and a battle like Rahav. I mean,
yes.
I think if you don't fight for it, it's very likely that you will be fall within the cracks.
Yes.
And you're now working against honor crimes.
Yes.
In Stockholm. I mean, a lot of great work that you're doing because you're now able to.
Yes, exactly. And it's like I had to go a little bit to an extreme, as you know, like, because after they rejected my case, I was thinking I was going to get deported, and I was thinking, okay, what can I do to prove to the migration board that I'm no longer a Muslim? And then I made a video and talked about my views and talked about my case, talked about the situation of ex-Muslims in Muslim-majority countries. About the situation in Egypt, like with people who criticize Islam and so on. And then I said that the only thing that no Muslim would ever do is to desecrate the Quran. And this is what I did on video. So I desecrated a copy of the Quran on video. And then first I showed this to some of my friends here who are aware of my case. They just freaked out and they said, okay, maybe you'll get the asylum, but we don't know if you will live long enough to enjoy it, even here in Sweden. I was like, yeah, but will this increase my chances? They said, yeah, but maybe send it to migration board first privately before going public with it. Then I did that, and I sent it to migration board and the same email to the Egyptian embassy, the Egyptian foreign ministry and the Egyptian interior ministry, so that they have, okay, here's your proof that they are aware of it.
So in a sense, they push you to extremes in order to be able to prove who you are. You know?
Yes,
that is your personal belief.
Yes, this is sometimes the case. Yes, yes, often the case, actually, I would say.
Why do you think it's so important for ex-Muslims to have asylum and protection in a place like Sweden or Europe or anywhere?
I think, like, in most of like Muslim majority countries, there is a very hostile climate towards ex-Muslims and people who criticize Islam and atheists, both socially and legally. So most countries are not safe for ex-Muslims to be open with their identity, to be open with their beliefs or lack of beliefs, or to exercise their freedom of conscience and freedom of thought, freedom of belief, and this is why it's very important for them to be able to get this protection, to be able to be fully free and safe.
But would you say to you know, the Home Office, for example, has told some of our activists that they could go back and live in Pakistan or Egypt or Iran and just not mention that they're ex-Muslims and just live discreetly, basically?
Yes, actually, at some point, this was something that was said to me as well. Like, I remember, like, Migration Board said something, like, in the, we had like a court session, and they said something that maybe when we return him back to Egypt, he will hide or change his views. I was like, but what kind of argument is that? So this is an argument that they use sometimes. The thing is, there's like two aspects how Migration Board evaluates like the asylum when it comes to ex-Muslims. One aspect is that they are this, like, their beliefs are genuine, and another aspect is that they would be perceived as such. They would be perceived as an atheist by other people, and hence this would put them in danger. And so if this other aspect is lacking, they don't see that there is a threat, so no need for asylum in that case. Yeah, so, but being silent, that is not, like, you can say this about anything, then. You can say this all, like, about being, like, any
don't
religion.
Show your gay. Don't
yeah,
show
yeah,
your
exactly.
Door,
yeah.
And then nothing will happen.
Yeah, nothing will happen to you.
I would never say that
no,
in that situation.
No.
Yeah.
No.
I guess I wanted to talk to you about why did you become an ex-Muslim? Because that would be interesting to know. Because
yeah,
everybody has different stories, don't they?
Yeah. I would say in my case, actually, it was my father who inadvertently made me an atheist. I know, right? I think there were many factors at play. Like my parents sent me to, like, private schools where everything was taught in English. So I started learning English when I was 4. And you kind of get into, like, almost some kind of subculture. So I was, like, reading mostly things that were produced outside of my own culture, like the movies. We have this saying in Egypt, like in many Muslim majority countries, they say the Western culture will corrupt the youth. There is some truth to that, but it's not exactly corruption from my point of view. But it's like kind of broadens your horizons a little bit, and like makes you think that there are other ways out there, and makes you think, like, okay, but why should I hate, like, gay people, or why do I think that men are superior to women, and so on, and maybe, like, other values that have to do, like, with human rights and equality and so on, they seem better. And then there was this conflict for a while, and another thing that my father encouraged me to read a lot. So I was reading a lot since I was, I was a weird child, like, spending a lot of time reading, and I think this kind of, like, developed some kind of, like, critical thinking, not taking just whatever people tell me for granted without thinking about it, and at some point, because most Muslims, they take religion out of inheritance, not out of conviction. And then when I started to think, okay, I was like, okay, I want to study the scripture and be really convinced of it myself, like reach my own conviction. And the funny thing is that I actually approached it from an angle that I wanted to confirm my faith in a way. And the more I studied the scripture, the more I was like, okay, it's not very nice. Doesn't make much sense. So at some point I decided, because there was, like, so many, like, contradictions in the hadith and the contradictions between the hadith and the Quran and so on. So I decided at some point to totally reject the hadith, and I became a Quranist. So relying only on the Quran for a while. Then I started to study the Quran a bit more and the history of Islam, and I was like, okay, this is I cannot salvage this. I cannot do anything. So I would say I rejected it on two fronts, both, like, rationally and ethically. So there was, like, too many things that didn't sit well with me ethically, like when it comes to, like, women's rights, when it comes to gay rights and so on. It was just, like, it's very difficult to reconcile the scripture with that. So this was one thing. The other thing, I found the idea of this, like, all-powerful God who could have created human beings in whatever form he wants, and he's, like, omniscient, all-seeing, and he knows the future. But he still creates human beings weak in order to sin. And then, even though he knew that beforehand, he still gets angry when they sin, and even though it's the way he created them, and even though he's all loving and this, like, omnibenevolent God, he sends them to burn in hell for eternity because of the way he created them, even though he knew all this would happen. This just didn't compute for me. So at some point I was like, okay.
What about your family and friends, and that you had when you were Muslim? How is that?
Yeah, there has been friction at some point, but they knew about my views only after I had left. So that there would have been more friction then. But I remember when same-sex marriage was legalized in the U.S. For some reason, it got really big in Egypt, and the people were pretty angry about it. And I had my cousins on Facebook and relatives and so on posting things like, how can they allow that, and what's next? They were legalized pedophilia and things like that. I was like, okay. And then there was this, maybe you remember that one, there was a picture that the Atheist Republic made with the Kaaba with the rainbow painted on it. So I posted that on Facebook, and whoa, it's like things went berserk, shit hit the roof. My relatives were cursing me on Facebook and blocking me, and my mother, basically, even though she's not on Facebook, but somebody went and told her, and she had almost a nervous breakdown, and it was a lot of mess. And this happened to be coincidentally the same day that I got my first rejection from Migration Board. Well, it was not a great day, that one. Yeah.
So. I guess as a final question, I would say, do you have any regrets about leaving Islam, and whether you had to leave your country, you had problems with your family?
No, I would not say so, because right now I would say that I live with full integrity, and I live according to the convictions that I really have, and I'm free. And this is, even though, we're never really totally safe, so to speak. But for me, I care much more about my freedom than my safety. So no regrets at all.
Thank you, Omar.
Thank you.